Hi, thank you all for coming to what may be one of our final poetry events of the year. Stay tuned, we may have news of another one that we're trying to cobble together. But for now, Jeffrey Yang is our last visiting poet in the Poem Present series. I'll just jump into my introduction and let Jeffrey take the stage. The venerable practice of transporting aquatic creatures from their native element to dwell in captivity among human beings is first recorded in ancient Rome, where a fish called the sea barbel was sometimes kept under guest beds in small tanks fashioned from marble. Hence our word aquarium, from the Latin root aqua, meaning water, and the suffix, and this is the pertinent part, the suffix arium, meaning a place for relating to. Since then, inhabitants of many different cultures have constructed such relational microcosms, from the Chinese Emperor Hongwu, who established a porcelain company expressly for the purpose of producing ceramic tubs to house goldfish, to the citizens of the British Empire, who made a popular hobby of aquarium keeping following the media sensation caused by the ornate cast iron fish tanks unveiled during the Great Exhibition of 1851. An aquarium is a place for relating to, yes, not only for the amateur hobbyist, but also across diverse geographies and historical eras and systems of belief. In Jeffrey Yang's first collection of poetry, An Aquarium, the fish tank becomes a kind of metaphysical think tank, a place for relating to, in which the poet cultivates a felicity of association among all manner of strange fish. Here we find Aristotle swimming between anemones and barnacles, Kenneth Rexroth afloat in the same waters of Jiangqi of the Northern Song Dynasty, and even a curious specimen called the U.S., which may be a fish out of water hooked up to a respirator, a Shiite Muslim fish with a Protestant upbringing, an army of robot fish, or an illegal fish with respect to its own laws, to name only a few of this profoundly political poet's visions of the Leviathan we find ourselves swallowed up by today. What does it mean to place a dinoflagellate in relation to the Hindu god Vishnu? To admire the coloration of the parrotfish and observe in the next breath that the CIA loved abstract expressionism. Like any thoughtful aquarium keeper, Yang never forces the various specimens of his literary imagination into association with one another. Instead, he releases the remora, the white whale, Google, and time itself into a space for relating to, and we are left to marvel at the poetic ecology that spontaneously assembles itself under the conditions of his verse. The relations are never spelled out for us, but rather we are left under the spell of associations in this remarkable collection. Indeed, spelling is as important as collecting in Yang's work, for an aquarium is not only a fish tank, but an abecedarium as well, a book organized alphabetically from abalone to zooxanthellae, mispronouncing it, I'm sure, furnishing its reader with an ABC for reading the world we ourselves swim through. Who speaks in the spellbinding collection, this aquarium, this place for relating to? Every reader will have her own guess, but I'm going with the starfish. For as Yang writes, starfish have neither brain nor heart. Perhaps their pure intellect of soul, pure coincidence, pure feeling clinging to the rocks of paradise. Jeffrey Yang is the author of two books of poetry, An Aquarium and Vanishing Line, forthcoming from Grey Wolf Press. Carrying on his relational poetics by other means, Yang has translated Zhu Xi's East Slope and a Tang Song Dynasty collection titled Rhythm 226. And he is presently at work on a translation of Liu Xiaobo's poetry as well. He is an editor at New Directions Publishing and a recipient of numerous awards and honors, including the Penn Osterweil Award for Poetry and a Lannan Foundation residency in Marfa, Texas. Please join me in welcoming Jeffrey Yang.
Thanks for that, Chico. Thanks for reminding me. Can you hear me? This isn't amplified. Oh, it doesn't. Okay. I'll just speak loudly. And thanks, Kate, for helping to organize this. It's great to be here. I thought I'd start with, I've been working, this will be my 11th year at New Directions as an editor, and it's also our 75th anniversary, and kind of for the occasion, I edited this book of nature poems that covers kind of the range of what we've been publishing poetry-wise for 75 years. It's called Birds, Beasts, and Seas, and it just came out last week, so I thought I'd just read around this a little bit and then continue on. So this is a little bit from the preface. Considering the nature poem, Frank O'Hara's comment about nature in painting thus seems to speak for nature in poetry. It depends on the historical period. Nature being multivalent and as fluid as our identities or a river reflects the changing times. It may be as eternally indifferent as the sun beating down on the rich and poor alike, but it is very much involved in the miracle of understanding, the infectious ecstasy of HD's biological reality. And as far back as words have existed, poets have pursued this miracle by composing poems of, about, for, to, in, around nature. Poets have asked, and nature has answered, often with more questions, heavenly or otherwise. If nature loves to hide, as Heraclitus says, then poetry has been lured into its most secret places of becoming. Over the centuries, the human beast has consistently trampled the planet's nature out of nature, so that today the scale of the destruction of nature has become a moral imperative of the most critical order. All the chlorinated hydrocarbons derived from petroleum and salts are man-made and otherwise never found in Earth's mantle lithosphere. The solvents, plastics, pesticides, and transportation industry waste filling air, land, and sea have real but immeasurable consequences. In this present of our own making and unmaking, perhaps a nature poem could, on one level, help focus our attention into an awareness of thought and need, as deeds follow the heels of words, each uniting the other. Robert Duncan translates Gerard de Nerval, "Respect in the animal an active intellect. Each flower is a soul and nature bloomed forth. A mystery of love lies concealed in the metal. Everything is sentient." And this is Sappho, translated by Guy Davenport. "Come out of Crete and find me here. Come to your grove, mellow apple trees, and holy altar, where the sweet smoke of labanum is in your praise, where leaf melody in the apples is a crystal crash and the water is cold. All roses in shadow this place, and sleep like dusk sifts down from trembling leaves. Here horses stand in flowers and graze. The wind is glad and sweet in its moving. Here, Kypris, pour nectar in the golden cups and mix it deftly with our dancing and mortal wine." I should say that all these poems could be traced to a New Directions book, which is kind of the constraint of this collection. And this is from Gerard Manley Hopkins' notebooks. "It is a happy thing that there is no royal road to poetry. The world should know by this time that one cannot reach Parnassus except by flying thither. Yet from time to time, more men go up and either perish in its gullies fluttering Excelsior flags or else come down again with full folios and blank countenances. Yet the old fallacy keeps its ground. Every age has its false alarms. Moonlight hanging or dropping on treetops like blue cobweb. Also, the upper sides of little grotted waves turned to the sky have soft, pale-colored cobwebs on them, the undersides green. Note that the beaded ore dripping powders or sows the smooth with dry silver drops. the sky minted into golden sequins, stars like gold tufts, golden bees, golden rowels. And this is a clip of Hugh McDermott's longish poem, On a Raised Beach. All is lithogenesis, or lochia, coprolite fruit of the forbidden tree, stones blacker than any in the Kaaba, cream-colored cayenne stone, chatoyant pieces, celadon and corbeau, bistre and beige, glaucous, hoar, enfoldered cyathiform, making mere faculae of the sun and moon. I study you glout and gloss, but have no cadrons to adjust you with, and turn again from optic to haptic, and like a blind man run my fingers over you, iris by iris, burr by burr, slick inside, truite, rugas fulvioles, bringing my aesthesis in vain to bear, an angle titch to all your corrugations and coins, hatched foraminous, cavo relevo of the world, deictic fiducial stones, Chiliad by Chiliad, what bricol piled you here, stupendous cairn? What artist poses the earth écorché thus, pillar of creation engulfed in me? What hibernation augments you with men's bones, every energumen and endominion yet? All the stones are in this haicity, it seems, but where is the crystallophanic rock that moved? What Kabirian song from this catasta comes? No heavier and colder and quieter then, no more motionless do stones lie in death than in life to all men. That's a hard one to read. Just a couple more from here. This is a poem by the Argentinian poet, Silvina Ocampo, and she was good friends with Borges. They had epic conversations around the table at night. And this poem called The Infinite Horses is translated from the Spanish by William Carlos Williams. I have seen them asleep on the grass, mirroring themselves in the fields. Seen them furious on their knees like haughty gods, all white, dressed in ribbons, savage, with manes flying like the loose hair of legend and sirens on the shores. Vile vipers have dreamt of them. Reeds and bedded mothers keep them closed in the palms. Trembling, they foretell battles, like the beat of their trotting hoofs, like applause thundering in a vast theater. They have seen wounds bleeding into the clay, dyed among flowers in the mire, intimates of birds and vermin. They draw near bearing armed men, approach on their backs vile tyrants dressed in blood and purple. I shall remember implacable horses, Russian trappings, the Przewalski, the names of the 120 Roman horses chiseled in marble. At the Olympus of Dionysus of Argos, with a hard penumbra aphrodisiac on their bronze flanks, the horse most favored by the others was that of Altis, he who was so loved by Semiramis, the queen of Asia. Those who tasted with blessed transports, long before the Chinese tasted them, green tea from those inspired leaves, that horse created by Virgil, whose benign and virtuous shadow was gifted with the power to heal all horses. I shall remember in an orange sky, horses so left in shadow, concernedly bringing lovers together in peaceful grottos from a distance. And this is by William Bronk. Aspects of the world like coral reefs. In the spring woods, how good it is to see again the trees, old company, how they have withstood the winter, their girth. By gradual actions, how the gross earth gathers around us and grows real, is there as though it were really there and is good. Certain stars of stupendous size are said to be such and such distances away, oh, farther than the eyes alone would ever see. Thus magnified, the whole evidence of our senses is belied, for it is not possible for miles to add miles to miles forever, not even if expressed as the speed of light. The fault lies partly in the idea of miles. It is absurd to describe the world in sensible terms. How good that even so, aspects of the world that are real or seem to be real should rise like reefs whose rough agglomerate smashes the sea. And the last poet from this book, this Danish poet, Inger Christensen. And this is two poems from her book called Butterfly Valley, a Requiem. And this is translated by Suzanne Need from the Danish. With peace of mind and fragments of sweet lies, with downy sheen of emerald and jade, the iris butterflies, bear caterpillars, can camouflage themselves as willow leaves. I saw them eating their own images, which then were folded into chrysalis, hanging at last like what they simulated, a leaf among the other clustered leaves. When, with their image language, butterflies can use dishonesty and so survive, then why should I be any less wise if it will soothe my terror of the void to characterize butterflies as souls and summer visions of the vanished dead? And summer visions of the vanished dead, the hawthorn butterfly that hovers like a white cloud splashed with deep pink traces of flowers interwoven by the light. My grandmother, enfolded in the garden's thousand fathoms, stalk, wallflower, baby's breath. My father, who taught me first names of all, the creatures that must creep before they die, walk with me into the butterfly valley, where everything exists only apart, where even the dead hear the nightingale. Its songs glide with an oddly mournful lilt from lack of suffering to suffering. My ear gives answer with its deafened ringing. And I thought I'd continue with animal theme with some poems from my book, An Aquarium. I was gonna read some of this tomorrow in the talk because it kind of figures into what I'm talking about. So I'll just read a few poems from here. That was really nice what you said about this book too. I was just still thinking about that. Okay, this is called Flounder. Silent on the sandy seafloor, the flounder sleeps. As you near its face, perspective reverses and the flounder dissimulates a dream of infinity. Foraminifera. Actually, so I was just down in Marfa, and there's a lot of private land there, but I was able to get on some land with this geologist from Oniaga, and we found cliff sides of foraminifera. It was really incredible just sitting there. The test of a foraminifera is its shell. Tectinous, agglutinated, or calcareous, endoskeleton, cytoplasm streams through foramen, chamber to chamber of a single cell, granulo reticulose pseudopodia motion, memory palace of Okeanos. Foraminiferins are found at all latitudes and marine environments, foraminiferal white of the white cliffs of Dover. In the pyramids of Giza, Herodotus saw petrified lentils. Aldrovandi's eye turned from Aristotle toward Galileo. The rhombic shells have epigenetic stony tubercles. For Oppen, a test of poetry is sincerity, clarity, respect. For Zhukovsky, the range of pleasure it affords is sight, sound, and intellection. In a dream, Vishnu visited Apakavi, who received the secrets of Nanaya's grammar. Poetry is the ultimate learning. Sponge. We have yet to understand the mystery of the sponge. A phylum unto itself, sponge fossils found in Doshan Tuo phosphorite are the most ancient of multicellular animals. The sponge lives at all depths of the sea, an array of colors, shapes, textures, canals, Goethe's paradise lacks coincidence. In reality, a sponge isn't a parasite unless it's human. Then it doesn't purify, but withers the world. Remember Kropotkin's mutual trust and support, Proudhon's exchange, Gandhi's boycotts. This is called Time. Outside the quincunx. The quincunx is that kind of rhombic shape that figures in this book. Philosophy's shadow, poetry. Poetry's shadow, philosophy. Poetry, art, revolt. Perspective absorbs perspective, time. Tide, the love of the moon for the earth. And triggerfish. The Hamahama Nukanukanuka Apua is Hawaii's native triggerfish. Pua'a means pig, one of many sacred animals born from the Kumulipo night. O ke akua ke komo, aoe komo kanaka. The god enters, man cannot enter, until the age passed from po to a'o. Cosmogony to cosmology, kalaka'ua to bastion to Frobenius pohaku, flower, bird, gatherer, gatherer of seeds, mayamboa, spirits who propitiate heaven, who believe one thinks with one's heart. Harmony, ka'ona. Pound, testing the overtones from his distant pithos, essay as citizen of cosmos, implosion of pohaku's dream, poetry, echo of Aquinas' happiness. The perfect activity of the intellect depends on right understanding. Divine quiddity around us, flora, fauna, fades, bay, slick with sunscreen, hama, 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 nuka, nuka, apuas, home reef, we cannot recreate. And I thought I'd read the last poem of this book, Zooxanthellae. And it's kind of where a lot of the threads and themes come together and then unravel again. Zooxanthellae. The Chinese world archetype can be compared to a chariot, heaven the canopy, earth the cart, magic square of 45 circles, 1 to 9, linked center of 5, each side and diagonals of 3 links sums 15, concealing a science of the mind. River of causes to investigate, ideal order that underlies an anthropology, a poetry the witness testifies and doesn't testify, a poetry of the jury. 7 years after 45, the first hydrogen bomb was detonated at Inuitok. Preparations had begun less than a year after 45 with Operation Crossroads at Bikini Atoll. The native people were forcibly moved from their ancestor home by the US government atoll to atoll while they starved, Bikini to Rongerik to Kwajalein to Kili. Abel and Baker, two Hiroshima-sized tests, contaminated the water and a fleet of World War II ships in Bikini's lagoon. Then came Operation Sandstone at Eniwetok, 3 atomic tests. Then Operation Greenhouse, 4 atomic tests. Then Operation Ivy, the first H-bomb test. And all the while, more forced migrations. Eniwetok to Kwajalein to Ujalang, Rongelap to La'i, Wotho to La'i, Ujalang to. The government named the H-bomb Mike. The blast vaporized Ilulissat Island. Probably more than 100 million tons of material were dislodged and thrown into the air. Great waves were sent out that rolled over nearby islands, and a huge mushroom cloud rose to a height of 130,000 feet in just 15 minutes. Mike was indeed a super device, estimated to have a yield of about 5 megatons, or the equivalent of 250 Hiroshima-type atomic bombs. Then 9 years after 45 came Operation Castle, created by Joint Task Force 7, the Army, Navy, Air Force, contractors, primarily from the firm Holmes and Narver, and Department of Defense people were all involved, along with 28 U.S. servicemen that formed a radiation safety team. This time, people of surrounding islands weren't moved, and Bravo was detonated on the ground of Bikini Atoll March 1st, 6:45 a.m. Kilo time, rather than above ground for minimal fallout, though all previous tests, like those in Nevada, were detonated above ground, and the weather conditions were downgraded to unfavorable. Also nearby, at the time of the blast, was a 23-man Japanese fishing boat, the Lucky Dragon, that risked being caught by the U.S. Navy in trust territory waters. Uranium-238, lithium-deuteride, uranium-235 metal mechanisms and circuitry erupted into a blinding white force of monstrous proportions of heat and radioactivity, accompanied by a deafening, thunderous roar and an earth and sea moving high pressure blast. By 6:55 a.m., Bravo's giant nuclear cloud reached a peak of 21.6 miles tall. The yield of Bravo is estimated to be near 20 megatons, or the equivalent of 1,000 Hiroshima-type bombs. Wind spread the cloud, particles fell. JTF-7 crew members aboard ships 30 miles east of Bikini were ordered to go below deck. The ships fled south. Fallout snow fell on the Lucky Dragon fishermen who caught it on their tongues, and then on the people of Rongelap and Ilingani, and then on the radiation safety team at Rongerik, though some were in planes monitoring the explosion, and then over Uderik and Ayaluk. Children played in the snow. 34 hours later, the 28 Americans were safe on ship after visiting Rongelap by amphibious plane and measuring the dangerously high levels of radiation. They left the people with 4 words: don't drink the water. One day after the Americans evacuated, JTF-7 converged on Rongelap and Ilingani to tell the people that they must leave immediately or would die. Then the people of Uderik were evacuated, but not the people of Ayaluk, though Ayaluk is nearly the same distance to Bikini as Uderik. The U.S. Atomic Commission issued a statement to the press calling Bravo a routine atomic test and that there were no burns, all reported well. In the following years, doctors from the Brookhaven National Laboratory, run by the U.S. Department of Energy, carefully documented the most valuable ecological radiation study on human beings. Since only small amounts of radioisotopes are necessary for tracer studies, the various radionuclides present on the island can be traced through the food and into the human being, where the tissue and organ distributions, biological half-times, and excretion rates can be studied. Tests and experiments were performed on the people. Some patients today still do not understand that their entire thyroids were removed, though human radiation experiments began long before, as described in Walsum's plutonium files. Project 4.1 was planned in New Mexico months before Bravo and was called Study of Response of Human Beings Exposed to Significant Beta and Gamma Radiation Due to Fallout from High-Yield Weapons. 2 years after Bravo came Operation Red Wing, then Operation Hardtack, then at least 67 atomic tests were performed. During these tests, a scientist discovers significant quantities of algae living in two places, in the sand and on dead coral, and inside the polyp tissues and skeletons of the coral themselves. This algae is a kind of dinoflagellate that lives symbiotically with the coral, supplying it with oxygen and nutrients through photosynthesis while transforming calcium ions from the ocean into calcium carbonate the coral uses to grow. In return, the coral provides the algae with a safe home and access to food like carbon dioxide and nitrogen. Here, finally, was proof that tropical reef communities operated according to the same fundamental laws of nature that govern other food chains, built on a foundation of plants and subsisting in an evolutionary relationship intimately defined by mutualism. The algae is called zooxanthellae. So I thought I'd switch gears again, and I'll read just a couple poems from this new book that's coming out. Any questions? Or so this is from this book, Vanishing Line, and I'll just read two parts of this. This is called Elegy for Ling. Spirit consumed by fire. Shaman warps to pig's head. Rain above open mouths. Doorway between shaman and rainfall. Ling, heart tone of the temple gate of the zero moon. Echo of jade brilliance, red phosphorus spirit, spirit of being, unmaking, ling, soul dim light flitting, eve splitting, Mabaroshi light, will-o'-the-wisp, drawing her near, across what distances, darknesses, ling, beyond the waste mountains, water streaming stones, that sound of water against stones, of jade pendants, of bells, of antelope horns among branches, of damask, of feathers of the creaking wheel, ling, unrecognizable behind the lattice, pages and pages floating down, scales, scars tearing apart, heart, sliver of light, ice, prison, to the measured position of the cracking entablature at the architrave's cusp, crumbling beneath her ling, looking down on the ruined city of her birth, facing the unraveling, the expanding, the contracting, the pull of the end, that night before the wedding, before her arrival. Where were you, ling, sewing the wedding dress, sewing the seconds, her little brother before her, the boy who jumped through the atrium, the boy with the gun, the boy who drowned, old men sorting through rubble, brick by brick, rebuilding the ancient walls while the ring roads expand, while the machinery explodes, the celebrity architects multiply, ignorant of the original design, coal in the lungs, sand in the lungs, carbon monoxide polychlorinated, biphenyl red dust in the lungs, the hanged woman's house sold, her belongings sold, windows barred, tree cursed, the man on his bicycle hit by a train. It was pouring rain on the forest, on the Thorpe tops, that night before the wedding, before her arrival. Ancient observatory wrapped between highways, between hotels and satellite dishes, billboards and metal cranes at the intersection, Taoists, Buddhists, Muslims, weighing the heavens, watching with bronze instruments on a roof of stone, before the Jesuits, before Verbius refitting his ruder muse, before stumps melting of the Rien, 3,300 years ago, a nova guest star recorded on an oracle bone. Now, gaseous haze for sky, electricity spinning arenaceous air, drowning perception of the forged inventions, armillary spheres, red road, equatorial, yellow road, ecliptic, quadrant, sextant, celestial globe, polar axis spins positioning the stars, dragon theodolite, azimuth theodolite, at theta, at teth, at sun, at death, like drowning in an open ocean, I see, wrote. The map was there, her laugh is there, alone with the signs, the patterns, the biochemicals, the codons, the proteins, translating, unfolding, the final despair of the final decision, eyes clear, eyes bright, to the received translation, Ling, cipher, spirit source, Ling, mystical deer, mystical fish, anteater, wagtail, dace, Ling, libeludle, winging water, chestnut, falling rain, through the threshold of the mind, of the wine, of the sill, of the thin stone porthole, boat bottle with handle, tilling channel, accumulating ice, Ling, tomb, plume, mound, coffin, ing of the Wu shaman, Quercus on Sumeru, lonely lake, wounding light, traversing the lintel, for us left, the looking forward, looking back at the bridge, at the river, without reconciliation, without expiation, sound breaking clear, ing, eyes of turquoise and coral cannot see, motherless children, love's innocence, children on the stairs. I thought I'd better end on a chipper note. So this is just a little section that I'll finish with. It's the last section of this poem called Yenicott. And it's nine sections of nine stanzas. Yenicott is an old name for this the North Fork, part of the North Fork of Long Island, and no one really knows what the word means anymore. Alone in the woods, near Running Brook, far from wind, shelter built, pyramid of bark, leaves, saplings, provisions set for the known hour. Light deepening late spring's colors, his eyes felt but hidden. Silence of birds and trees, silence of breath, waves of pain beginning, silence of walking feet, silence of song cradling belly, her voice so sweet, sap rise, soft bed of moss, butterfly and dragonfly, wild flowers all, root drink. Sun fading, falling through branches, pain still pain without sin, panis angelius fit panis hominum, as it was at the sacred table, breath returning through the door of horn, vanishes on swift wings through the ivory door. Circle of fire, embers floating to stars, divine spark inside, breathing, breathing, I am coming, Mezingwa is coming, I am here. Beaver appeared, then otter, muskrat, toad on a lily lotus, turtle's slow search, earth rocked, tectonic web, spider's net, Mezingwa astride deer, face red, black mask, eponym of peace, of silence, steps, breath, making the forest, opening the path, thoughts born of words, you are not myself nor any other, we are thoughts. Surrounded by water and darkness, immersed in the sound of her heart, if this is blindness, what is sight before memory? They walked toward me from a great distance, and clothed me in garments of sun, faces so familiar from a city of bridges, city of stone, city of ring roads, waterway fields, now dust motes in a sunbeam. They rubbed my back and my feet, whispered sweet words to me, brought me food and drink. So thirsty I stood alone as they danced around me, knowledge and acknowledged, salt flowing down my body, a vessel, my blood, my water mixing with earth, chorus not of silence or sun, but of the child, the cries in my arms. Stepped into water to wash by dawn's first light. I carried her, she carried my heart, unsequestered forest. Mezingwa's breath, everything living emotion, motion in stillness, water clear as the air was clear, the earth, my thoughts, hers. And after many days of water silence, naps and dreams, her milk feeding my heart, her voice, gentle wind, her face, blossoming sky, I returned to the village of nine houses without a name, uprooted, not yet born, calling me, tears of the father. Thanks.